Hello, everybody. Let us begin our talk with the mantra of the universe in its purity. Om Nam. Om Nam. Om Nam. Om Nam. Om Nam. Very much. What is this? Correct. At this point, we could finish the talk. But I think many of us would be disappointed by that. Okay? So Zen is very, very simple. During this series of talks, you could hear many complex explanations. And that's like exercise for your thinking. But Zen is very, very simple. Okay? We had a lot of understanding. We exchanged a lot of questions and answers. And today's talk is about not understanding. Okay? So there was a monk long time ago in a Zen monastery somewhere in China, okay? And he was not a bad person. He was a very simple-minded but a little obtuse person, not clever. But he had a sincere heart. So he tried what we did the previous time, understand the sutras. But he always fell asleep. Always. You know, start to read the sutras, then started to bob, you know, bob and boom, hit the sutra blocks. So after like 1 or 2 years, they said, okay, you don't read sutras, okay? He tried Zen. He did Zen. But even meditation was not so suitable for him. He tried to sit, but after a while also just... you know, was sitting like this, then one day, boom, hit the floor. So, couldn't do Zen. Too heavy karma. Chanting, forget it. You know, absolutely, not so good voice, so out. They figured out that he could only do working Zen. And this working Zen, you know, was kind of acceptable for him, but he already got the name of Soktu. Soktu means rock head, okay? Sok is rock and du is head. So they called him Soktu Hwasang, okay? So his job was carrying firewood. He carried firewood from high up the mountain, and he was bringing it down to the monastery and then back up again every single day. And one day, some question came up in his mind, and as he was walking past the Zen master who was in the courtyard, he drops his wood and asks, Zen master, can I have a question? He says, you? Of course. What is Buddha? Then Zen master says, Jibshim Shibul, which means, you know, mind is Buddha. But he didn't understand it correctly. He understood Jikshim Shibul. So there was, Buddha is a pair of grass shoes. So he hears that, and it really hit, boom, hits his mind like a truck. So, what? Buddha is a pair of grass shoes? Impossible. What? I mean, Zen master said that, so it must be true. So he understood a little bit how to, you know, study Zen, although he couldn't do it so well. So he says, okay, that's my koan. Buddha is a pair of grass shoes. What does that really mean? So he continued carrying his, you know, his firewood. And at that time, all the monks were wearing grass shoes. There was no other shoes. They made it themselves, you know. Usually, they made it themselves. And many months passed. He was carrying firewood with this question in his mind. What is the meaning of Buddha is grass shoes? And he was carrying his firewood. So, autumn came. The autumn rainy season came. And the slopes became very slippery. So he was carrying the firewood down, down, down. And he just misses his steps, slips, falls, firewood completely disintegrates. And he turns around once, twice, and he loses the shoes in the fall. And as he just stops his rolling, the shoes land, boom, right next to him. Then, you see, ah, that's the meaning. Buddha is a pair of grass shoes. So he runs down to the monastery and immediately calls the Zen master and says, now I understand, Buddha is a pair of grass shoes. So then the Zen master says, really? So what is Buddha? Then he says, my shoes are broken. So then the Zen master was laughing. Go, take a little rest, okay? So I'm saying this because you don't have to be such a high-class intellect to attain enlightenment. We have many, many Zen stories where people were really, really, truly rockheads. Okay? And yet they got it. Okay. Another kind of example is Lin Chi or Rinzai or Imje Sunim himself. He was in Huangpo's monastery and he could meditate, but his connection with the teacher was not so good. So 3-4 years pass and he says, well, I really don't understand what I'm doing here. The master doesn't notice me. I don't get any teaching. I do my job, but not much is happening. So maybe I don't have good karma with this place. I don't have good karma with this teacher. So I have to move on. And he tells the head monk, I'm leaving. Head monk says, okay, you leave, but first say goodbye to the master. Okay. Appointment was made. He goes into Huangpo's place. He bows 3 times and says, master, I'm leaving. Please give me some final teaching. Then Huangpo just got his stick, bang, 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 beat him. Lin Chi was shocked. Why? Why is this happening? I didn't make any mistake. So he stumbles out of the room and says to the head monk, well, now I know I really don't have good karma with him, you know. I just went in to say goodbye and he beat me. Then head monk says, okay, wait. Maybe you didn't understand his teachings. Me? How would I not understand his teaching? His stick was all over my back, you know. Then the head monk says, okay, just give him some time, okay? You try the next day, but don't go without his final teaching, okay? So, okay, I can wait one more day. So next day he goes in and he bows and says, master, I came to say goodbye because I really cannot stay in this place. So I'm going. Then Huangpo, without saying anything, again, bang, 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 bang. Lin Chi was shocked again. You know, he was respectful. He was, in a way, sad. He was sorrowful. He just gets the beating again. He's angry, toasts the head monk. Says, you know, I really respected this master until now, but now I have serious doubts. I mean, he just beat me again without any reason. And then the head monk says, you know, everything has a third time in Asia. So you should wait a little bit and very, very respectfully ask for his final teaching before you leave. So Lingzhi doesn't like it. He really doesn't like the idea, but still, the myth of Huang Po was so great. He was such a great Zen master. And he says, okay, I shouldn't make mistake. Maybe Zen master makes mistake. I shouldn't. So I go in there and I try for the third time. So he goes in, bows, and says, please, Zen master, give me your farewell teaching because I have to go from this place. So then Huang Po just grabs his stick and bang, 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 beats him for the third time. And he says after that, as Lingzhi just stomps out of the room, go find this and this Zen master in this and this monastery. That's it. So Lingzhi starts to walk. Takes a couple of days to reach that monastery. He goes to, I think, to Shan, that was the Zen master. And he bows to him and says, I come from Huang Po's monastery. I'm sorry to intrude. I had really bad karma with the master. He beat me three times. I tried to get his teaching and he beat me three times. So Zen Master Teshan says, so you asked for his teaching and he hit you? Yes! Very hard! So then this Zen Master says, you don't understand anything. You're like a young cow peeing into your own bed. Huang Po was as kind to you as your own grandmother. Then Lingzhi gets it. Okay? And he grabs Teshan's stick and tries to, you know, hit him. And then Teshan holds his head and says, no, you are not my business. Go back to Huang Po. Okay? So Lingzhi is very happy. He is running back to Huang Po's monastery and just runs straight into his room, grabs the stick and wants to hit him. Then Huang Po says, you cannot hit me today. Okay? So Lingzhi stops totally. Then next day the Dharma talk comes and Huang Po saw what happened. And during the Dharma speech he says, of among all of you, there is one man whose teeth are like the big monster and his mouth has this blood spurting and he swallows the seven seas. That's actually a way of describing that somebody attained an enlightenment, okay? So Lingzhi became one of Huang Po's successors, you know? So Zen is really not like this very visible step-by-step gradual path, you know? For a long time, nothing happens. You're only trying to clean your karma. You're only suffering sometimes, lots of suffering during meditation. One day, it's like that. This is not a promise, but that's the way it works. Okay? You don't know when, you don't know how, but you just keep this not thinking mind. Keep this before thinking mind. And again, like a while ago, I remind that if you break the wall of yourself, you become infinite in time and space. Now this break, it doesn't happen step by step. Keeping this mind, taking your karma away, that's a step by step procedure. How to use this mind, that's actually a very careful process. But this sudden, bam, okay, that cannot be done by little steps. That's why our path is called, the sudden enlightenment school, okay? But saying this is already a mistake, you know? If you look back the sixth patriarch, he gave a very wonderful teaching in the Platform Sutra saying, originally, no sudden, no gradual. Our mind doesn't depend on these concepts. But if we want to describe it, that's the way it works. Anybody, any questions?
Well, why beating helps, it seems that beating helps to attain.
Come here. Let me ask you, Hubertus. Can you listen to the sound of the machine outside? So when you 100% listen to the sound of the machine outside, what happens? That's it. So if this is 100% filling your mind, can you think?
normal.
That's what this hit does. Okay? So either outside hit or inside donna. Same result. Avalokiteshvara is the bodhisattva of compassion because you perceive sound. Kwanse okay, perceive the world's sound. So when you perceive the sound, you have no thinking. So when Lin Chi got completely beaten by Huang Po, he had no thinking. He had very strong idea. That's why Huang Po, bang, bang. Okay? So it had this strong rebounding effect that the mind just, boom, got into a shock. And then later opened up. So when Huang Po beat Lin Chi, the seed was planted very deep. And by the time he got to the next monastery and had his interaction with Shan, if I'm not mistaken by the name, then the lotus opened up. So this no-thinking experience, that's what we are all here for. But we bow, we chant, we sit, etc., we go for interviews. So it's a little different method than just being beaten. Okay? And if you don't have the teaching, and there's only the physical act of being beaten, nothing comes out. Otherwise, all the kickboxers would get it in 2 seconds, you know? You know? And it doesn't happen that way. More questions? Yeah.
One question I had about family karma, but there was no time.
No problem. Mm-hmm. Ask anything.
So about that, but there are things which I recognized in my grandfather, my mother, in me, and my brother. And I know that they repeat always. But what I need to do with this? Or I need to try to change something, but it's very difficult. Or it never stops.
We had very important teaching about karma. So you know that karma does not exist by itself. That's number one important point. You can take this karma away. Also, you can create more of this. It's up to you. But to be able to do that, you must come back to this point. You must come back to the primary point of no thinking, no karma. Okay? And when you have that, then you can change karma. So when people are attached to their karma, they cannot do anything. They don't see it. So that's attachment. Then they see what they've done and, oh my God, mistake. So then it's reflection. When you reflect that karma, then you say, I'm not going to do this again. And inside, you go back, where does this come from? Then you attain the zero point. That means no karma. You take it away. It's possible. That's why you are practicing. And then, correct karma. Only for others. Only to help all beings. Okay? Only then you use that. You know? But for that, your mind has to be very clear. So that's the way you can generally work with your karma. If you don't want it, you have to first see it, take it away, and when a totally different situation appears, then you use that. Okay? And considering family karma, this generation question is very, very important also. People talk about these hereditary things, that they inherit things from their parents. I'm very sorry to say, but this is total illusion. It's not the way it works. You have a certain mindset, okay? And because of that, you are born to a specific pair of parents. So these karmas, they keep each other alive. They wake each other up. So you're born to them because your mind and their minds are connected. So you have similarities and differences. And the differences attract you. And the similarities keep you at a distance. So when the balance of these forces of attraction and detachment, they balance out, then relationship appears. If it's too strong, they annihilate each other like fire. If it's too weak, they don't come any close. But being born to somebody means very strong opposites. Because opposites attract each other. but that you can stay parent and child, you can have a kind of existing relationship, some similarities have to appear. So it's not your grandfather's karma going over to your parents' karma going over to your karma, to your being. No, everybody in the family originally from previous life had some similarity, and that's why they were born to each other. And as they were raising each other, your grandparents raised your parents were raising you, they woke up, okay? They woke up these karmas inside the next generation. So it's not that you give it over. It just doesn't work. Like, oh, my son is born, so I give my karma over. That's what people try, but that's where they fail, because they cannot put their ideas into their children. It's a mistake to try to do that. Okay, helping the kid waking up, that's important, okay? In fact, you cannot do anything else. Whether you like it or not, you wake up the kid's karma and you have to deal with it. So that's why you are born to each other. Because your problem, your unfinished karma is manifesting in your kid. You know? And also, your wonderful bodhisattva mind to unconditionally care for another being, you know, unconditionally, really strongly love one, you know, person, that's parent and child relationship, you know. So, see it from a very practical and clear point of view. You have your kind of storehouse consciousness and discriminative consciousness, and that took this body. So you started to think and feel, sense, perceive, the five skandhas began to interact and operate. And your parents gave you your, you know, your body, but you brought your mind. Okay? So depending on the mind, you get the body. Remember the temple rules? If you die tomorrow, what kind of body will you get? Isn't this the most important question for your mind? Hurry up, hurry. Okay? In the great work of life and death, time will not wait for you. And then later on it says, cloud goes up to the heaven, water flows down to the sea. Okay?
But there is one problem. You know, always it says practicing, just keep practicing. Mm-hmm. Yes? But when I am with Sangha, and then central or in quest, so like for in now in Hungary, so I want practicing and I understand that it's very good. But when I came back to my daily life, I just don't want practicing.
Yeah, because your daily life is good.
Maybe that.
Yeah, it's good. You keep yourself occupied with work, with relationships, etc. So then your individual karma takes over. And if your individual karma takes over, you will not want to practice because you feel good. But the moment some critical situation appears, where is your center? Where is your stamina? Where is your wisdom? Where is your compassion? Where is your power? So Zen practice, like I said before, is for the bad times. When you have a conflict, when somebody wants to break your heart, wants to break your life, you know, wants to do really something bad for you, okay? Sometimes people want that.
Like help in computer.
I don't know what is, you know, your critical point or what's your kind of karmic pain point. You know that. But the truth is, be prepared, because one day we all die. Are we actually prepared for that? So, yeah, your life is good, but when it's really good and you want to get lost in something, want to get lost in some kind of good feeling, before you get lost in it, you have to see that it doesn't last forever. And when it's over, you just got older a little bit. That's it. You had something really good, something you liked, something you can become attached to, but what did that really solve for you? It didn't solve anything. It gave you some good time. Sometimes we need that. Okay? Sometimes we have good food, we have entertainment, we have etc., etc. What did that really solve in your life? What kind of deep question did you have an answer to just by having a good time or a good life? Not much. So if you remember this, then you don't have to become depressed by impermanence. Build practicing into your life. So when you build this practice into your life, you can really be in the moment, and when enjoyment comes, you enjoy. When sad times come, you have some, you know, strength. But if you become attached to something, if you get lost in something, in everyday life, in some good situation, whatever, then you lose your center. And when you lose your center, you become very vulnerable to any change, to anything that can break that situation. And then big suffering appears. Last question.
That was asked yesterday, but it's not clear for me. So Zen Master Wubong said that, actually I didn't understand what he said about animal enlightenment. And you mentioned that they cannot reach enlightenment, but our cat likes listening mantras actually, so maybe it helps her in some way, I hope. So can you talk about this more?
Actually, you should ask your cat. Your cat understands this better than I do, okay? So sometimes you see very intelligent animals. I mean, there was a very famous Hungarian horse called Kincsem. I mean, that horse won many, many races. And there was a myth around this horse that this horse understood the mind of the rider before the rider or the jockey wanted to do anything. So animals can be very special. Sometimes cats or dogs or some other pets, they can become supremely intelligent, okay? No doubt, no doubt. But although the cat likes mantras, you know, it cannot stop behaving like a cat, you know? Next lifetime. So if you have anything unclear about, you know, the previous day's talk, you ask Zen Master Wubong, you get a very good answer. You want to know why the cat likes mantra? Ask the cat. Then you will get a beautiful answer. And in this place, just enjoy the blue sky and the green trees. Thank you very much.